Hey everyone, welcome back to Magic TV. I am Tristan Shaun Gregson here with Luis Scott-Vargas, and this time the full Scars of Mirrodin spoiler thanks to Wizards of the Coast.
Yeah, and the visual spoiler went up and I spent, you know, a good 20 minutes scrolling through seeing if there's anything sweet, and yeah, there's some sweet stuff. I mean,
we'll see how many of my highlighted cards match up with your picks for what's interesting. Just starting with white, as we do now. We're supposed to do that.
Wooburg.
Right? Yes, yes. The first guy that jumped out to me was the Glimmer Point Stag. Did you look at that guy?
I did, and then I was like, this card's pretty good and limited, and then I kept going.
Okay, okay.
Comes into play, flickers for white two. And a 3/3?
Yeah.
I mean, he's like a flicker wisp.
He's got vigilance.
But worse stats, because I'd rather pay one less and be a 3/1 flyer. What are you planning on flickering that is so awesome?
I'm not sure. I mean, there's all this talk about what Venser can do. I thought maybe make it cheaper, put it on a guy. Maybe we could do something with this card. Great and limited, that's pretty much it.
Like, pick it relatively high and limited. That is my plan for Glimmer Points.
With that said, it seems like white's pretty good for limited.
It is.
Okay, well, we'll move on then. Let's talk about the Smith cycle, the first one being Mirrorsmith, which to me seems like it's the best one.
I think
for limited.
For limited.
Yes.
The red one is going to be pretty good, too. I mean, pinging for a point, making a 1/1 are both, like,
so much,
depending
so
on the
so much Metalcraft, a white creature that makes artifact creatures?
Yeah, the fact that the white one powers up Metalcraft, like, you play a Mirrorsmith and you play another guy and make an artifact, you have Metalcraft off two artifacts instead of just, you know, there are three. Mm-hmm. And then you play a few more and they're not going to be able to get you off Metalcraft, because, you know, one of the big downsides to Metalcraft is you've got these, like, let's say you have two of the Grizzly Bears that are 4/4s with Metalcraft. You know, mid-combat, they shatter an artifact, all of a sudden you have two Grizzly Bears again. Yeah, that could be awkward.
Yeah.
But the Mirrorsmith, it does a pretty good job of cranking out an army of guys, so you're always Metalcrafted.
Oh, we could stop and talk about the Smith cycle, I mean.
Yeah, the blue one is the Merfolk Looter, which he seems like he has the most potential in Constructed, actually, to me. Because it doesn't cost mana to use it, and it works well with Grand Architect. And Grand Architect's a pretty sweet card.
Well, okay, well, let's not get too far ahead of ourselves. It's funny, a lot of people were saying, like, what's the bad one? Like, probably the green one, you gain life, right?
Yeah, that's generally...
Plus two, plus O could be pretty relevant off the black one.
And Death Touch.
Yes.
So
yes.
Plus two, plus O, especially with Infect, is really a good combination.
That's more what I was thinking in this format. It doesn't seem like plus two, plus O and Death Touch is going to be as prevalent in a format where there seems to be a lot of X1s.
Yeah,
making
but
that other Smith pretty good, too.
Yeah, the red one's obviously pretty insane, so...
Okay, moving on from there. How do you say that? Inexorable Tide?
The blue inexorable?
Inexorable, there we go. Inexorable Tide.
Oh, the classic, like, here's the set's mechanic, here's the 5-mana enchantment that goes with it, like Maelstrom Nexus or 7-mana one cast through time, etc.
Yeah, there we go.
I think it fits into that category of...
What are those cards
here's
that...
Here's this card that you can build a deck around and no one actually will, so...
Not that it's blue, not that it has this planeswalker.
Just as inexorable as the Tide is the fact that paying 5 mana to put a keyword on something is just not going to be good enough.
It's not format breaking. It's not.
Yeah. It's an interesting card, and a lot of these cards end up people, you know, making fun decks out of them, and they certainly are interesting for that. But in terms of tournaments, I can't recall any of these cards being good enough for tournament play.
Okay, this one has not broken that either at this point.
Correct.
We've got the new Phoenix. What is it? The
Kul'Dotha Phoenix.
Yes.
Yeah, he's pretty good. Being able to, like, bash them and then, you know, bring them back and bash them again, etc. Like, if there's, like, a big red-style deck with a lot of artifacts, like Everflung Chalice, Matt Nass put Pilgrim's Eye in the deck in his article that went up earlier this week, and Pilgrim's Eye actually looks pretty good for that. You know, various other artifacts, then Kul'Dotha Phoenix is a reality, and it's not the worst even if you don't have Metalcraft, although right. You're not going to play in a deck that can't bring it.
This
back.
Is one of the few cards where, without the Metalcraft portion, it's still a fine card.
Yeah, not playable and constructed without Metalcraft, but you don't have to have guaranteed Metalcraft for it to be good enough.
We've lost Hell's Thunder. You don't think this is kind of a suitable replacement even without the Metalcraft?
Like... Yeah, the problem is, like, Hell's Thunder is the kind of card where one of the strengths was even if they had a Doomblade, you know, you're still getting an
advantage.
You're
still going to get them.
Without Metalcraft, you don't get an advantage out of this. So, I don't think it's going to show up in Constructed in any deck that can't ever bring it back. But I don't think you need to have 25 artifacts in your deck to make it good. You can run with a kind of a bare minimum, and then if you Metalcraft it, it's like a bonus.
That's pretty exciting.
Definitely.
This is probably my favorite card that's not very...
It's probably going in your cube, I would imagine.
We'll see. I don't know.
Well, I'm saying because it's not good in cube. That's what I'm going to put it in.
That's great. Speaking of more limited cards, we have Viridian Shaman's bigger beastie brother was the Oxidius
Scrap Melter. Yeah, I mean, it's
just as huge in draft as...
Way better than Viridian Shaman or Manic Vandals, because a Hell Giant is more relevant than a Grey Ogre. And I doubt it's going to miss very often in this set. It's big enough that even if it does miss, it's good. Manic Vandal, you know, you play it, but if you don't see any artifacts, you often side it out, or you don't even manic it. But this, I don't think it's ever going to come out of my deck.
I mean, to
although,
me...
Although, is it optional? It is not optional, correct?
I don't think... Well, yeah, I have a big problem with that, so...
Yeah.
Yeah, it's not optional. It's a must.
So if you had a bunch of artifacts and they somehow had none, you could board it out.
But come on.
That doesn't seem that likely. I'm just saying, that's a situation.
A lot of people who never played Mirrodin Limited, we're kind of like joking, like, oh, you would first pick Shatter in a bad pack? Or like, oh, yeah, all day long. Where this card...
Yeah, but on the other hand, once the format got deep, there were specific decks drafted specifically to not have artifacts. Like, you know, red-green like beatdown or red-green control in Mirrodin block, where you went out of your way to not play an artifacts to blank all their shatters and deconstructs and whatnot. So if someone were to draft a deck like that and you had this guy in your deck, you might take it out.
He's still fine.
Well, if you're the only one with artifacts, then you probably can't play it.
You just made the argument saying that Hill Giant's going to be better than Grey Ogre in that circumstance.
Yeah, but I'm saying, like, if you have 12 artifacts in your deck and they have zero, I probably wouldn't want this guy in my deck. A Hill Giant that has a drawback is not good enough.
True.
So, I'm not saying this is going to come up very often.
No.
But that's the situation where I'd board him out. Otherwise, I probably wouldn't.
Okay. We also have the new Elf Lord, Elrazi.
Yeah, the guy who regenerates Renegade elves leader. And...
Coincidentally, overruns.
Overruns. He can't regenerate himself, but he can overrun himself. Again, this is another deck that went into one of Matt Nass's brews. Of course, Matt Nass made elves. He looks like he's pretty good. He's a way to use the ton of mana you generate with Elvish Archdruid. You accelerate him out. He protects against Day of Judgment, which is funny.
That is pretty good.
You play him with like one or two mana up, and if they day, you're still going to have a guy or two left over.
It seems like turn two or three Archdruid followed by this guy.
Yeah, it's going to set up for a kill pretty fast.
Well, I mean, you have the multi-threat, because that way you can Archdruid, save the rest of your elves.
Or overrun. Exactly.
So I originally when I saw him, I was like, well, he's going to be compared to other Elf Lords, but really he seems like a great complement to the current one.
Yeah, exactly. He's not a card you'd play over Archdruid, you'd play with it. So.
So the question on, I'm sure, many people's minds, Luis Scott-Vargas, do you think that makes elves a potentially viable type 2 deck?
Yeah, I mean, I think elves was somewhat close before, but so the fact that like Sovereigns of Lost Alara existed and was the best way to sink your mana into made it so there's no point in playing elves because you might as well play Lotus Cobra, Birds, Hierarch, and play Sovereigns. But now that that's not around anymore, playing Llanowar Elves and Arbor Elf into Elvish Archdruid into this guy or Eldrazi Monument might actually be good enough.
Yeah. I mean, it was the deck, in my mind, the deck still kind of existed just with Eldrazi Monument, but now you have...
Yeah, but again, Sovereigns kind of blanked
right,
it, because
that
was just the best mid-range card you could cast. But now that that's gone, it's opening the door for new strategies like this. So yeah, I wouldn't be too surprised to find Eldrazi Monuments and Overruns or Overwhelming Stampedes, you know.
Excellent.
Duraga Warcaller also goes well in this sort of deck.
Yeah. What do you think about Withstand Death? The new foe regeneration green instant.
Oh, the indestructible?
Yes.
It's interesting. Again, it gets around Day of Judgment. It gets around Doomblade. It's like a Vines of Vastwood that can protect from mass removal, which probably makes it better because Vines, the +4/+4, you weren't playing as much as the, you know, making a guy untargetable. Still, in the end, I don't know if you need that sort of effect. But it's certainly something to keep in mind.
We just talked about how with elves, like, you've... Like, you're protecting all your other guys.
Yeah.
And you don't have a creature like Sovereigns of Lost Alara in the new Type 2. You wouldn't necessarily need it.
Right.
And, I mean, as far as, like, Limited goes, it functions almost the same as the card Regenerate.
Yeah. In Limited, it's much worse than Vines, because the +4/+4 of Vines was really relevant. So, and this is still probably playable in Limited if they have a lot of removal, but I don't think I'd randomly start it. It's also not good against Infect guys, because they wither your guy, and it doesn't matter if he's indestructible.
Okay. Good to know. Talking about effect, Infect in Limited, and that kind of being an archetype, now that we've seen the full spoiler, I'm interested to see where that archetype kind of falls. It's green-black for
green,
the most
black,
part.
Green-black, yeah.
Where, like, the change in
well,
the pick order.
Well, plus some artifacts. So just green and black and artifacts.
Yeah, and the kind of like the common card that kind of stuck out most to me would be the Corpse Cur, the 2/2 infect for 4, where you Gravedigger's an infect guy.
Oh wow, yeah, that really rewards you for playing a lot of infect.
And it's colorless. I mean, granted, it seems like right now, like the infect deck, if you were to draft it, is just green black.
Yeah.
But it definitely seems like having access to that common.
You have to be green or black. You don't have to be green and black. I could definitely see you making an infect deck with like green X or black X. It just depends on the support you get and how many infect guys you get in your one color. I'd assume they have a bit roughly equal in each color because that just makes sense. But I haven't actually checked the numbers on that. But in that case, yeah, I mean, you could draft like black red with, you know, removal spells, or green blue with blue, you know, pitching and bounce and card draw. So you definitely don't have to be just green black. Although, of course, that gets you the most infect guys, which is kind of the idea.
Yeah, so effectively your life, your opponent starts at 10, and all your guy, or the majority of your threats in your deck have wither, which seems really good.
Yeah, it's pretty good. I mean, if all your guys have wither, I mean, that's reasonable, but you still don't want to see a bunch of 4/4s if all you have is 2/2s. And the infect guys don't tend to be very big.
No, I mean, you're looking at a lot of 2-power creatures.
So I think what you want, if you're drafting heavy infect, you want cards like equipment, or like the Trigon of Rage that gives a guy +2/+0. Cards that can boost your power are pretty good, because otherwise you end up with a lot of 2/2s, and if your opponent just plays mono hill giants, like, you actually end up on the losing proposition. Like, you trade your, you know, you trade guys, they end up with a 1/1, but your guy's dead, and like, that gives them a slight advantage on every trade they make. So.
Oh, since we're almost at the, or we are in the artifact section already, let's stop and talk about those Trigons. Are you familiar with all 5 of them?
Yeah.
Or 6 if you include the colorless tap one?
The tumble magnet?
Yes.
They all seem decent except for the life gain one. The life gain one, that's the white one, right?
Yes, the white one. Why couldn't it have been prevent damage?
Yeah, that would be sweet.
Why could have been like the shard cycle from Mirrodin instead as Trigons?
Well, yeah, I mean, the problem was the blue shard was just unbelievable and the green shard was unplayable. But
so is the blue Trigon unbelievable? How good is it?
I can't tell that without actually drafting the set. Okay. I don't want to make, you know, predictions and have them just be wrong.
I mean, it conveniently costs the most. It costs 5.
Yeah. Okay. So if you looking at the card looks really good. Like, if it was an M11, the card would be pretty good. I mean, but some decks wouldn't.
M11?
Yeah.
Okay.
Because the format is slow.
Oh, okay.
I'm saying, like, if it was in Zendikar, the card would be flat unplayable. Well, hopefully Scars is more on the, you know, side of not being like Zendikar than anything else, but
you can always hope it's more like Rise.
Well, if in Rise the blue Trigon would be a first pick, and in Zendikar would be a last pick. And the reason is, in Rise you have time to screw around with 5 mana things that just draw you cards. In Zendikar you really didn't. So I hope it's good. It would be a good format if it's good, and I imagine it's probably going to be good. It looks good to me. Like, 5 mana, you know, you draw 3 times, then you can start charging it up, but you don't even necessarily need to. You might have enough gas at that point.
Well, that was the cute thing about the shard cycle, was that any deck could draft them. There was just a bonus for having that color
exactly.
Deck. And I'm trying to, like, again, you look at these cards and you're like, well, let's say I'm not the blue drafter at all. Yeah. I'm red black. How much value do I get out of that card?
Yeah, like for example, the black one is going to be, like, oh, they're all going to be good. The ones that are good are going to be good in any color deck. And the white one I don't think is that good. The rest seem pretty good, though. And they're going to be good in any deck, and they'll be even better in the color of deck. Of course, costing double color means you can't, like, splash it.
Right.
Like, the shards you would play where, like, most of the time you'd pay 3 to activate it, but every now and then you'd draw your 1 silver mirror or your red talisman. And then, you know, get it for free. But in this, with double color, that's not going to happen very often, but you'd still probably play it. I mean, I can't. The red one, maybe you don't play unless you can charge it, but the red one needs a specific deck to be good anyway. So.
Seems pretty good in the infect deck.
Yeah, you want to be aggressive or have infect.
Okay. Let's see here. Oh, I got my Viridian Longbow, the heavy arbalest.
Yes, the heavy arbalest that it takes a while to use, and, you know, once you crank it, and fire, you're stunned for a turn.
I definitely think it's pretty.
It's pretty good, though.
Yeah. Let's see here. I think we have to wrap it up, actually. I'm getting the signal.
The bat signal?
Yeah.
I mean, those are the cards that on first blush look pretty good for limited. We didn't really talk about constructed too much.
Well, we'll be back.
But I'm sure we'll have time to talk about, and, you know, me to correct you and all that sort of thing.
Oh, okay. All right, well,
thanks for watching.
On that note, yeah.